Welcome to Re'eh Yisrael, which means in English, Behold, O Israel, the Bible-teaching television ministry of Congregation Shema Yisrael. Shema Yisrael is a Messianic Jewish congregation in Rochester, New York. Be sure to get out your Bible and a notebook and follow along with this week's lesson from the Scriptures. Shalom. Thank you for watching this video. I'm taking a moment to share some important information about Congregation Shema Yisrael. We are following the leading of the Ruach HaKodesh, the Holy Spirit, to purchase a new facility for our congregation in the heart of the Jewish community of Rochester, New York. We've experienced several miraculous confirmations that this purchase is God's plan to make us more effective in our outreach to the Jewish community here. Our previous facility has been sold, and we are meeting in rented quarters until we close on the new facility at the end of 2020. Through the generous donations of our regular attenders, we've raised a significant part of the funds that will be needed to close, but we also need your help. If you've been blessed by our videos, please pray for us and ask the Lord, what do you want to do through me to accomplish your will for Congregation Shema Yisrael? If you pray this prayer and do what God leads you to do in faith, we will succeed in purchasing this facility and become much more effective in reaching the Jewish people of Rochester with the life-saving good news of Messiah Yeshua. To participate, please visit shematime.org, that's shematime.org, where you can learn more about this amazing move of God and where you can support us by clicking the donate button. Thank you, and may the Lord richly bless you as you watch this video.
What am I wanting? You know, the things we want can drive us into doing all sorts of things. For instance, a priest, a minister, and a rabbi all wanted some more money, and so they decided to chip in and buy a lottery ticket. And to their surprise, they won the grand prize of $1 million. The priest said, "This is such a blessing, but we need to give some to God. I know what we can do. We'll draw a circle on the ground and throw the money up in the air. Whatever lands out of the circle we'll keep, and whatever lands in the circle we'll give to God." The minister said, "Well, you know, it's kind of windy today. I think we should throw the money up in the air, and whatever lands inside the circle we keep, whatever lands outside the circle we'll give to God." They looked to the rabbi to get his opinion. He said, "Yeah, you're right. We should throw the money up in the air, and whatever God wants, he can keep, and whatever lands on the ground, we'll keep." Little out of character, but our wants drive us into that, isn't it? You know, everybody wants something. From the time that we're little babies, we want to be held, we want to be fed, and right up until our last breath, we have wants and we have desires. The Rolling Stones lamented our inability to acquire things we desire by singing, "You can't always get what you want." Now, what they wanted may not have been good and pure, but the title of it is true anyways. We can't always get what we want, and sometimes that's a good thing, isn't it? Advertising seems to be aimed at convincing us there's something else we want, we just don't know it yet. One moment we don't know it exists, and the next moment we desire it and may even come to believe that we can't live without it. The big question, are you ready for this? Do you want what God wants you to give up more than what he wants to give you? Now consider that question carefully, because if the answer is yes, then you will continue to struggle with sin, iniquity, and transgression. The mind fight will continue to rage, and the best you can do is hope to cope with the fight going on in your mind and hope to win more often than you lose. If we're not careful, we can deceive ourselves into believing that we want only what is pleasing to God, when we actually have desires that are contrary to his wishes. Sometimes we have a clear idea of what God wants us to give up. Other times we're not so sure. In either case, we may not comprehend what he wants to give us in exchange what we're giving up. I don't know what he wants to give me. But one thing we can be sure of, whatever God wants to give us in exchange for what we give up will be accompanied by an increase in the fruit of the Spirit. Galatians chapter 5, verses 20 through to 23 tell us the fruit of the Spirit, of the Ruach, the Spirit, is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Against such things there is no law. Do you want more love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faith, gentleness, and self-control in your life? Well, it may mean deciding to change some things you want in order to get it. See, my proposition is being what God wants us to be will be much easier when we want what God wants us to want. The first point I want to make is what we want can satisfy us. Another Rolling Stones song, I can't get no satisfaction. It's not very good grammar. They put it this way. When I'm driving in the car and a man comes on the radio, he's telling me more and more about some useless information supposed to fire my imagination. The singer is apparently satisfied only when the radio is playing what he wants to hear. I don't blame him. I feel the same way. Later, the song gives another reason for lack of satisfaction in the singer's life. Unwanted things on TV. When I'm watching my TV and the man comes on and tells me how white my shirts can be, but he can't be a man because he doesn't smoke the same cigarettes as me. I don't smoke anymore, so I can't identify completely. But that's his idea of satisfaction. He's not getting what he wants. What we want is incredibly important in our lives and is the main factor in determining how satisfied we are with our lives. True satisfaction occurs when we have what we want. Because we all want to be satisfied when given a choice, we will tend to choose what we want the most. For example, some people like both chocolate or vanilla ice cream equally. The flavor doesn't matter. Others, however, prefer one or the other, and they will tend to choose either chocolate or vanilla almost all the time. They pick whatever they want more, whatever they like more, whatever they think is the better choice. In many cases, what we want doesn't have much impact on the battle going on in our minds. However, in extreme cases, our wants can be harmful to ourselves and to others. For example, we may want to eat foods that are harmful to our health. And we find that instead of being pleasurable, eating can become a fight to not eat what we want to eat or to eat what we don't want to eat. It's no longer enjoyable. Likewise, imagine a bank teller who wants to take some of the money. Every minute on the job can cause a battle in the mind, depending on how strong the desire is to take that money. First point, what we want can satisfy us. The second point I want to make is what we want can tempt us. Temptation involves things that we want. We're not usually tempted by something we don't want. Think about a food you dislike. Have you got one in your mind? It's the food you absolutely don't want. Are you ever tempted to eat it? You could be in a room full of it, and you wouldn't eat it. Now think about a food you want the most. I'm sorry, you're probably hungry. How often are you tempted by that food? Okay. Quick search on the internet brings up lots of lists of foods that people dislike, including liver, kale, okra, spinach, raw onions, beetroot, turnips, avocado, licorice, anchovies or other seafood, Brussels sprouts, cottage cheese, and eggplant, to name a few. Now, some of us are going, yum, and some of us are going, ugh. Hopefully that just took away the appetite that thinking about the good food gave you. Now, you may like some of the foods on this list, but you most likely won't be tempted to eat what you don't want to eat. Some people, however, actually desire foods that other people don't want. Have you noticed that? How can you eat that? How can you not eat it? In a speech on March 22nd, 1990, President George Bush said, I do not like broccoli, and I haven't liked it since I was a little kid, and my mother made me eat it, and I'm president of the United States, and I'm not going to eat any more broccoli. He continued, but wait a minute, for the broccoli vote out there, Barbara loves broccoli. She's tried to make me eat it. She eats it all the time herself. Interesting. Again, we're tempted by the things that we want. And when we are tempted to sin, we have a choice. We can either choose to sin or we can choose to not sin. It's just that simple, isn't it? When we want the sinful choice more than we want the godly choice, we will always have a fight going on in our mind. We may understand what we should or should not do or think, but we're inclined to do otherwise. In our mind, it is not always easy to do the right thing because we want to do something else. When we choose to sin, there's something that we want more than intimacy with God. Adam and Eve, for example, wanted to eat the fruit more than they wanted a close relationship with God. We're all in this mess today because of that, aren't we? God had an intimate relationship with Adam. We're told in Genesis 2, verses 16 and 17, Adonai Elohim commanded the man, saying, "From all the trees of the garden you are most welcome to eat, but the tree of the knowledge of good and evil you must not eat. For when you eat from it, you most assuredly will die." God's command was pretty clear, wasn't it? Don't eat the fruit from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. Pretty easy to understand. However, Adam and Eve chose to hang around the tree. And eventually they wanted the fruit. Genesis 3 verse 6 tells us, "Now the woman saw that the tree was good for food, and that it was a thing of lust for the eyes, and the tree was desirable for imparting wisdom. So she took of its fruit, and she ate. She also gave to her husband, who was with her, and he ate." See, they both decided eating the fruit was more important to them than the relationship with God was. The decision was costly for them, for their children, for the generations after, all the way down to us, and opened the door for an intense fight with the enemy of our souls. The first point, what we want can satisfy us. Second, what we want can tempt us. Third, what we want can lead us to sin. David was the second king of Israel. The Bible tells us that God chose him to be king because he was a man after God's own heart. Paul tells us in Acts 13, verses 21 and 22, "Then they asked for a king, and God gave them Saul, son of Kish, of the tribe of Benjamin, for 40 years. After removing him, he raised up David to be their king. He also testified about him and said, 'I have found David, the son of Jesse, a man after my own heart, to do my will.'" Man after God's own heart. While walking on the roof, the man after God's own heart happened to see a woman named Bathsheba bathing and chose to enter into an adulterous relationship with her. 2 Samuel 11, starting at verse 1, tells us, "Now it came to pass at the turn of the year, at the time when kings go out to battle, that David sent Joab and his officials with him and all Israel, and they destroyed the children of Ammon and besieged Rabbah. But David stayed in Jerusalem." Someplace where he wasn't supposed to be. "One evening, David rose from his bed and strolled on the roof of the royal palace. Then from the roof, he saw a woman washing, a very beautiful woman. So David sent someone to inquire about the woman, and he reported, 'Isn't this Bathsheba, the daughter of Eliam, wife of Uriah the Hittite?'" I suppose if her name was Shower Sheba, she would have taken a shower and would have had a curtain around her, and he wouldn't have seen it, maybe. Anyway, David then sent messengers and took her, and when she came to him, he lay with her. She had purified herself from her uncleanness. Then she returned to her house. See, like Adam and Eve, David was somewhere he shouldn't have been, wanting something he should not have wanted, and the results were tragic. Now, I think we can say David most likely wanted to please God, and he wanted to be a good king. when we read the Psalms that he wrote, it shows that he had a great relationship with God. However, he also wanted to look at a naked woman who was not his wife instead of making a covenant with his eyes like Job did. He wanted to pursue an intimate relationship with a woman who wasn't available for him. And finally, although David wanted to please God, he wanted to sleep with Bathsheba more. Apparently, David also had some things in his heart that were not after God's own heart. He ended up falling because he chose what he wanted, what he liked, what he thought was the better choice at the moment. As David found out, our wrong desires can lead us into sin. James chapter 1, verses 13 through 15 say, "Let no one say when he is tempted, 'I am being tempted by God,' for God cannot be tempted by evil, and he himself tempts no one." Does God ever tempt you? Okay. He goes on, "But each one is tempted when he is dragged away and enticed by his own desire. Then when desire has conceived, it gives birth to sin, and when sin is full grown, it brings forth death." The things God wants for us are for our own good. He intends for us to be free from the bondage of sin and wants us eternally with him. When we are choosing to sin, we're essentially telling God we don't want what he wants for us. We want what we want for us. We're distancing ourselves from him. We're limiting our intimacy with him. We are rejecting him. I hate to say it that way, but that's the plain truth. People who are struggling with sexual sin, for instance, whether it be pornography, adultery, homosexuality, premarital sex, or masturbation, are choosing what they want to do, and because they want to do these things, they're tempted by them. You may already understand this, but still find yourself making the wrong choices because you're tempted by the things you want. Well, there's some good news. The fourth point I want to make today is what we want can change. Clearly, our wants and desires are the roots of our temptations and can have an adverse impact on the mind fight. And you may say, "I have no control over what I want." Please don't let yourself be in bondage to that lie. Please don't let yourself, if you think that thought, renounce it immediately. That's not true. First, our desires can and do change. For example, we no longer want many of the things we wanted as children. It's a natural change for most of us. As toddlers, we may have been happy playing with blocks, but as we grew older, blocks no longer made us happy. We desired other things. As we grow up, sometimes we may still play with toys for younger children. I know I do. Although it can be fun, we usually get bored of childish things. Imagine what it would be like if we all spoke in baby talk, drank from baby bottles, demanded to be fed, drooled, or slopped food all over ourselves when we ate. Okay, I know, sometimes I'm guilty of that. At least some of those things, maybe we all are. But here's what Paul tells us about coming what God intends us to become. 1 Corinthians 13, verse 11 says, "When I was a child, I spoke like a child, I thought like a child, I reasoned like a child. When I became a man, I put away childish things." Second, we can change what we desire. It is actually possible to change what we desire. Taken to the extreme, a habit or a mental stronghold is formed by thinking about or doing something repeatedly. For example, many people do not like certain foods or beverages at first. However, when they choose to consume those foods and beverages for a period of time, they become accustomed to them and over time may actually prefer them. In order to reduce fat intake, many people switch from drinking whole milk to 2% or 1% or even skim milk, and at first it just doesn't taste right. But after a while, it becomes acceptable. Many people who start out drinking coffee with tea or tea with cream and sugar are able to significantly reduce or eliminate the cream and sugar by slowly decreasing it over a period of several weeks. It's not unusual for people who have done this to actually dislike the coffee the way they used to like it and to prefer it without the cream or sugar. Now, some of us do it out of laziness. That's how I found this out. We don't feel like taking the time to fix up the coffee, or out of forgetfulness, we keep forgetting to get the supplies at the grocery store that we ran out of. In any case, with some effort, we can begin to want foods that are healthier and dislike foods that are unhealthier. It takes effort. Try it. It works. How many of you still prefer eating baby food after switching to table food? Now, you may have fussed when you first got the table food, but your tastes have changed. See, this kind of change is a positive stronghold. Perhaps this is what Paul was referring to when he said in Ephesians 4, verses 22 to 24, "With respect to your former lifestyle, you are to lay aside the old self corrupted by its deceitful desires, be renewed in the spirit of your mind, and put on the new self created to be like God in true righteousness and holiness." Third, to some extent, we can actually choose to not desire something. The Hebrew words kamad and ava are translated as desire or covet in many English translations of the Bible. Both of those words are used in Deuteronomy 5 verse 18 or 5:21 in many English Bibles, which says, do not covet your neighbor's wife, nor desire your neighbor's house, his field, his manservant, his maidservant, his ox, his donkey, or anything that belongs to your neighbor. Although some versions switch the order of the use of their words in that verse, or they might even use completely different words, the idea is God is commanding us to choose to not want some things. Don't want those things. Stop wanting them, is what he's saying. Will God ever command us to do something we're incapable of doing? He wouldn't be a just God if he did. And so since he won't command us to do something we're unable to do, this implies we do have control over our desires. Fourth, we can choose what we set our minds on. In his letter to the believers at Colossae, Paul clearly told when we believe in Messiah, we are capable of changing what we desire. Colossians 3, verses 1 through 5 say, "Therefore, if you have been raised up with Messiah, keep seeking the things above where Messiah is, sitting at the right hand of God. Focus your mind on things above, not on the things of the earth, for you have died and your life is hidden with Messiah in God. When Messiah, who is your life, is revealed, then you also will be revealed with him in glory. Therefore, put to death what is earthly in you, sexual immorality, impurity, lust, evil desire, and greed, for that is idolatry." When we want things contrary to what God wants, that's idolatry. For the most part, we're happiest when we're doing what we want to do. Doing what we want to do is the easy choice for us. The thing we are doing is not the most important consideration. What is important is that we're doing what we want. Think about it for a moment. People can be happy doing almost anything as long as they want to do it. When our desires change, the things that make us happy change. The things that tempt us change. Why are many athletes able to spend so much time and effort training while most of us find it difficult to spend only a few hours a week working out? Why are actors able to devote hours and hours to learning a part in a play? Why are many musicians able to practice for hours while many of us get bored with practice and give up before mastering an instrument or just settle at not being very good? In most cases, they focus their mind on doing what they do so that they can be what they want to be. In short, they want to do what they are doing, and so therefore, they're able to do it. The good news, the fifth point, what we want can be changed by God. See, God can change our desires. This is an important part of what God wants to do in our lives. This is part of the process of sanctification. Our wants or desires are in our hearts, and we must be willing to have a change of heart. David wrote in Psalm 37, verses 4 and 5, "Delight yourself in Adonai, and he will give you the requests of your heart. Commit your way to Adonai, trust in him, and he will do it." Many versions use the word desires of your heart instead of requests. When we choose to delight ourselves in God, he gives us the requests or the desires of our heart. Now, this doesn't mean he will give us what we're wanting now. Oh, God, I want a Ferrari. I'm going to delight myself in you. It means our requests or our desires will become godly. The benefit to that is we'll find ourselves in a position where we're not always fighting our desires. Instead, we can let God change what we desire to be in agreement with his will for us. When we choose to delight ourselves in God, much of the temptation that causes the mind fight will be eliminated. We will be tempted to do what God wants us to do. This is the key. Delight yourselves in Adonai. In Isaiah 58:14, the prophet used the same phrase, delight yourself in Adonai. In the preceding verses, he told us things like feeding the hungry, caring for the homeless, clothing the naked, being available to your family, and honoring Shabbat God's way instead of our own way is how we delight ourselves in Adonai. Isaiah 58, starting at verse 6. "Is not this the fast I chose, to release the bonds of wickedness, to untie the cords of the yoke, to let the oppressed go free and to tear off every yoke? Is it not to share your bread with the hungry, to bring the homeless poor into your house, when you see the naked to cover him and not hide yourself from your own flesh and blood? If you turn your foot back from Shabbat, from doing your pleasure on my holy day, and call Shabbat a delight, the holy day of Adonai honorable, if you honor it, not going your own ways, not seeking your own pleasure, nor speaking your usual speech," listen to this, "then you will delight yourself in Adonai, and I will let you ride over the heavens and the earth. I will feed you with the heritage of your father Jacob, for the mouth of Adonai has spoken." When we do those things, we delight ourselves in Adonai. Do you delight yourself? How do you show it? He just told us many of the things. See, the heart or core of people is wicked by nature. The Old Testament prophet Jeremiah said in chapter 17, verse 9, "The heart is deceitful above all things and incurable. Who can know it?" Many of the versions use the phrase desperately wicked instead of incurable. You see, without intervention, we automatically have our heart set on many things. We desire what God does not want us to have, and as a result, we are tempted to go sin by things that we want. Only the Holy Spirit can change our heart so that it is set for what God wants for us. Jeremiah also predicted a new agreement between God and man that would be able to change this condition. Jeremiah 31:33 says, "This is the covenant I will make with the house of Israel after those days. It is a declaration of Adonai. I will put my Torah within them. Yes, I will write it on their heart, and I will be their God, and they will be my people." According to the prophet Ezekiel, God said in Ezekiel 26, verses 26 and 27, "Moreover, I will give you a new heart. I will put a new spirit within you. I will remove the stony heart from your flesh and give you a heart of flesh. I will put my ruach within you. Then I will cause you to walk in my laws, so you will keep my rulings and do them." God can change our hearts. if we let him, if we want him to do it. God will change our hearts when we accept his new covenant the way he tells us the new covenant is, and when we delight in him. And when this happens, we will find that what is in our heart is no longer in conflict with God. When you recognize that you want what God wants you to give up more than you want what he wants to give you, it's important to take action. Do something. I always say the spirits that are keeping us in bondage, if we don't impact them, they will impact us. If we don't try to toss them out, they will try to take us over. It's up to us, along with God. See, otherwise temptation, when it comes upon you, you'll find yourself inclined to choose what you want more, what you like more, what you think is the better choice. But the first step is to do what David did after he sinned by doing what he wanted with Bathsheba. Confess the sin directly to God with no excuses, asking for forgiveness. Psalm 51, verses 4 through 6, 2 to 4 in most English versions. Wash me thoroughly from my iniquity and cleanse me from my sin. For I know my transgressions, and my sin is ever before you. Against you, you only have I sinned and done what is evil in your sight, so that you are just when you speak and blameless when you judge. The only way to fully correct this problem, then, is to ask God to create a new heart in you, just like David did. Psalm 51, verses 12 to 14. 10 to 12 in English versions. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a steadfast spirit within me. Do not cast me from your presence. Take not your Ruach HaKodesh from me. Restore to me the joy of your salvation and sustain me with a willing spirit. God can change the heart. Yeshua gave us some more insight into this principle. Matthew 6, verses 19 through 21, he tells us, do not store up for yourself treasures on earth where moth and rust destroy and where thieves break in and steal. But store up for yourselves treasures in heaven where neither moth nor rust destroys and where thieves do not break in or steal. For where your treasure is, say it with me, there your heart will be also. We have a choice over what we treasure, what we choose to make important in our heart. If we choose to treasure things of the flesh, hatred, pride, sexual immorality, pornography, drugs, lying, cheating, stealing, material possessions, money, and so on, our hearts will be set on those things. Doing what God wants us to do will be contrary to what's in our heart. Making the right choice will be difficult. Will be tempted to do what God does not want us to do. However, if we choose to treasure godly things, loving God and other people, humility, kindness, goodness, purity, honesty, God's word, and so on, doing what God wants us to do will be far easier. We'll be doing what we treasure. We will be doing what's in our heart. We will be tempted to do what God wants us to do. Our treasure is the critical part of the goodness of our heart. Yeshua put it this way in Matthew 12, verse 35, the good man or woman from his or her good treasure brings forth good, and the evil man or woman from his or her evil treasury brings forth evil. Goodness comes from the treasure in our heart, so does evil. If purity is more important to me than sexual immorality, I will find it easier to stay pure. If I treasure truth more than lying, I will find it easier to be truthful. If honesty is more important to me than stealing, it will be easier to choose not to steal. If we treasure loving our neighbor as ourselves more than treating others badly, we will find it easier to treat people the way God wants us to treat them. If loving God is more important to me than loving things, it will be easier to do what God wants me to do. Godly behavior will become the natural way of expressing my love for him. Treasuring the things of God is a choice that we have to make if we're ever going to be on the winning side of the mind fight. Yeshua gives some suggestions. Matthew 13, verses 44 through 46, he says, "The kingdom of heaven is like a treasure hidden in a field, which a man found and hid. And because of his joy, he goes out and sells all that he has and buys that field." Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a merchant searching for fine pearls. Upon finding a pearl of great value, he went out and sold all that he had and bought it. How important is the kingdom of heaven to you? What are you willing to pay for it? You decide. God gives us that chance. Either you make God and his kingdom your treasure, or you don't. Understand, however, that you cannot be on the winning side of the mind fight unless the kingdom of God is what you treasure. God is the most necessary component required to be on the winning side of the mind fight. In fact, he's the one who ultimately wins it for us. You cannot be victorious without God, and when we allow God to change our hearts and minds, we will be living according to the mind of Messiah. That's exactly what the mind of Messiah is, set on the things of God. If you don't want what God desires for you, can you at least choose to want what he wants for you? Do you want to want what God wants you to want? See, in his letter to the assembly at Corinth, the Apostle Paul said he learned to be content in all things. He was saying if he's well-fed or not, if he's rich or poor, it doesn't matter. And later on, he said, "I can do all things through Messiah who strengthens me." We do things through Messiah. We treasure the right things. So I want to give an application for everybody here today. I hope it's meant something. What are you doing to show your delight in God? If you're really delighted in him, you'll make it a practice of reading the Bible daily, getting to know and understand him better. If he's really your treasure, you'll choose to have regular fellowship with other believers, assume your position in the body of Messiah. You'll do things to show him that you love him. I want you to pause for a moment and ask God how he wants to show your delight in him. I have a prayer here. We can say it out loud together. Dear Heavenly Father, I confess that at times I do not delight in you. In some ways, you and your kingdom are not my treasure. Please tell me the ways that you would have me delight in you and treasure you. I want to make you the treasure of my life, and I want only to delight in you. In Yeshua's holy name, amen. Now take a moment and think about the things that he's telling you right now. What has he spoken to you? If you've heard something, commit yourself to practicing what he's telling you to do so that he will change what's in your heart. Let's commit that to him in prayer with this next prayer. Father in heaven, I commit myself to delighting in you and treasuring you by whatever he told you, speak it. Thank you for changing my heart into what you desire it to be. In Yeshua's holy name, amen. See, we often do things simply because we want to do them, or we don't do them because we don't want to. Our lives should not be trying really hard to do things we don't want to do or not to do the things we do want to do. When our hearts are aligned with God's will for our life, we'll find we're able to do what we want to do without sinning. The key is to want to do what God wants us to do. Let's ask God to reveal some things that you want that are not in line with his will for us, as well as things you don't want that he wants us to want, by saying the following prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, I know that what you want is best for me. Sometimes, however, I desire things that you don't want for me, and I don't want things that you do desire for me. I want to live according to your will for my life. Please reveal to me the things that I want that are contrary to your will for me. Also, show me the things I should want that I don't currently desire. I want to want only what you want me to want. In Yeshua's holy name, amen. On the next slide, I have some ungodly things that I thought of. You may have come up with some other ones. See if there's any of these that God revealed to you. Misusing alcohol or drugs, pornography, sexual immorality, overeating or unhealthy eating, laziness, wasting time, lying, greed, anger and rage, foul language, malice, vengeance, slander, stealing, abusing others, making myself more important than others, music, TV, videos, movies, books that don't glorify God or that do glorify sinfulness, and maybe there are some other ungodly things. What I'd like to do is take a moment now in the next prayer to confess those things to God that He's revealed to you, whatever it is. Lord Yeshua, I confess that I have wanted, name those things that you have wanted. I renounce these desires as being sinful and ungodly, and I desire to not want these things anymore. I only desire what you want for me. Please create in me a heart that conforms to your desires for my life. Amen. And here are some godly things that maybe we don't want. Regular prayer, daily Bible reading, assembling regularly with believers, tithes and offerings, serving God with my body, taking my position in the body of Messiah, being led by the Spirit of God, being kind and patient to others, treating others as I want to be treated, loving others, especially my spouse and family members, forgiving others, humbling myself, being faithful and honest at all times, taking responsibility for myself, and any other godly things that God has revealed to you. For each of these items that God has revealed, let's confess and renounce them now. Lord Yeshua, I confess that I have not wanted whatever those things are, just name them. I renounce my lack of desire as being sinful and ungodly, and I desire to want these things. I want to not desire what you do not want for me. Please create in me a heart that conforms to your desires for my life. Amen. Finally, let's take a moment and just thank God for what He's doing for us. Father in heaven, thank you that your word says you will change my heart. I choose to delight myself in you so that you will give me the desires of my heart. I choose to set my mind on you and the things above so that I can be the person you created me to be. I want to want only what you want me to want. Thank you for your work in my life. In the precious name of Yeshua, I pray. Amen. Now it's up to you to keep putting this into practice. Keep with it. Break the strongholds down. Change your mind. When the old thoughts come back, delight yourself in God. Renounce those sinful things. Announce the things that you should want. Renounce what the devil's telling you. Announce what God is telling you. Keep examining what you're wanting. And choose to want what God wants you to want. Make the choice daily, and you will find that a lot of the struggle will go away out of your life. Continue delighting yourself in God, and He will give you the desires of your heart. So, Heavenly Father, I just pray that for each and every person here today that you have revealed things to, that you will be with them in the coming days, and you will help them to delight themselves in you, that you will help them to treasure the things that you want them to want so that their desires will change to be in accordance with your will, and they will slam the doors on the enemy of our soul. They will close the door on the devil. They will break the chains that come from wanting things that you don't want us to want. So I just ask you, Abba Father, with each and every person, that you will give them the desires of their heart because they delight themselves in you. Change our hearts, change our minds in the name of Yeshua HaMashiach, our Lord. Amen.